Speaking of rash. Oh my gosh, Rash from Battletoads? What is this? Smash Brothers? Come on, game designers, get with it! Boy, I'm sick. Rash is the first out of three guest characters to be introduced in Season 3, hailing from the Rareware classic Battletoads. For those of you who don't know, Battletoads was a co-op beat-em-up on the NES that was infamous for being blisteringly difficult. It's a fun game for those who don't have the tendency to murder their girlfriend sitting right next to them, and Microsoft has definitely put in a lot of love and passion into this character. So many attack animations and references that'll make you smile. Rash also has one of the best personalities in the entire game with his snarky and cocky attitude, and this carries over into his moveset. He's another typical Rushdown character, as I'm sure you come to expect from this game, and his moveset can be summed up in one word: silly. He can sprout horns from his head to rush at the opponent, turn his feet into oversized cleats and do this, and he can turn into a wrecking ball to smash into his wrecking ball. Okay, that's fine, I'm not gonna question it. Rash is the definition of the phrase, what you see is what you get. And then there's his ultra. It's silly, it's over the top, it's friggin' Battletoads. Rash is already pretty good, but throw in that instinct of his and you're gonna dominate your opponents faster than you could say zits. Yeah, Rash is really good. A little too good. And while I see that as a positive, that's also the main reason why he isn't any higher. Most of his moves cover most hitboxes, but his move's cooldown is way too fast, letting you pull off one move, and in a split second, he can act or dominate his opponent with his grab, leaving his opponents almost no window to attack if he's used right. And that tongue technique of his is broken. And that's only because he's so good already. With one click of the LB button, he can extend his tongue to latch onto his opponents, or he can use it to dash in any direction. As if it wasn't broken enough already, it has the ability to absorb almost all projectiles. Seriously, Rare, it's like you haven't hurt me enough with the Beaver Bother minigame and those damn turbo tunnels. He's so overpowered that I can't play as him unless I turn the difficulty to very hard or fight an overly competent fighter online. It's not really a reason to hate him, though. In fact, I prefer playing him over any of the other previous characters. But seriously, tone this monster down. At least give him his own stage. I think he's deserved it, what with all the online matches he's been dominating. Coming up next is the leader of the Locust Army from Gears of War, General Rom. This makes him the second guest character to appear on the list, and you're probably wondering, what the heck is a Locust anyway? I mean, besides the obvious. Well, let's find out. Gears of War is a launch title for the 360, created to be a rival of the acclaimed PlayStation franchise, God of War. It's a decent over-the-shoulder shooter that focuses on a bunch of mercenaries trying to help end the war against the Locusts. A bunch of ugly reptilian creatures that were buried underneath the Earth's surface, until one day they broke out and decided to invade the Earth and jumpstart an apocalypse. All led by their esteemed general, Rom. You almost never see him throughout the game, with the exception being only 3 times, and underneath that bland personality, he was shown to be strong enough to grab a chainsaw without suffering a scratch. But despite being so forgettable and being such a pain in the ass to kill, Killer Instinct's General Rom isn't gonna let us forget him anytime soon. His main weapon of choice is his knife, and that might seem pretty stupid at first, especially coming from the game he hails from, but that's really all he needs. General Rom is another bruiser character like Tusk, but what he lacks in range, he makes up for in tanking hits. He hits like a truck, but he attacks much faster. But you see, it's not just the physical attacks you gotta watch out for. The krill that he leaves on his victims after a certain move will swarm the enemy for a few seconds and cause damage over time. And then there's his instinct that covers the whole screen with a giant krill swarm that will camouflage Rom and deal a ton of potential damage to the opponent for a few seconds. And his ultra, while not the flashiest, has one of the catchiest beats in the entire game. I do have one small problem with him though. In Killer Instinct, there are 3 things with the main combat: the combo opener, the combo linker, and the combo ender. And out of 4 or so moves, including a command grab, General Rom only has 2 linkers. Which is a shame because he doesn't have as much to work with in terms of combo potential, but if you can get past all that and main him, then those stab marks will be the least of your opponent's worries. Warning, if you have arachnophobia, then this is the point of the video where you might want to run, because Sidira is every arachnophobic's worst nightmare. Terrified? Well, you should be, because fighting Sadira makes her the reincarnation of Satan, even amongst pro players. Sadira is the leader of a group of assassins called the Red Eye of Rylai, brought out for hire by Ultratech to clear the way. And that's just scratching the surface of her backstory. I was pretty curious, so I did some research. If you look through the Wikipedia or collector dossiers in Shadowlords mode, you'll find out that Sadira was once born and raised by the Red Eyes of Rylai. It's not really explained what this cult was all about, but all it said was that the leader of the clan at the time took Sadira under her wing. But Sadira later betrayed and killed her master, and stole a necklace that gave her the powers of a spider. So at least that explains where her powers come from. And shortly after, she took over the clan herself, and the rest is history. I guess Devorah isn't the only fighter with control over insects. Sadira plays a lot like Spider-Man in Marvel vs. Capcom 3. What that means is that if you like to jump during a match, then this chick is for you. She can rush down with her pirouette of blades and kicks, but she can even throw daggers while she's in the air, and even create webs to bounce off her positioning. It's tricky to get used to, but hey, that's the magic of fighting games. And her instinct is the main responsibility of my pain and suffering in this game. With this, she can summon spiderwebs anywhere on the stage. These webs of hers are great for interrupting opponents and leaving them open for punishment or for juggling opportunities. This, combined with her playstyle, makes her one of the best characters in the game if you just want to be annoying. I should also add that her stage music is so friggin' creepy, but the stage itself is just kinda forgettable in my opinion. The main reason that Sadira isn't any higher is because I just don't have as much hands-on experience playing as her. Even though I've had a lot of bad experiences fighting her, I don't see that as a reason to hate her. Oh, F you! Imhotep, eat your heart out, because the real antagonist of the Mummy is coming your way. Now let me just warn you to strap in, because this is where things get complicated. Khonra was once the trusted vizier of an ancient Babylonian king over a millennium ago. He wanted the throne for himself and hypnotized the king's wife into killing him, but it didn't go exactly as he planned, thus causing the queen to kill herself out of guilt, having Khonra stripped of his title, and given a curse that causes his flesh and organs to decay faster. But because the king was a friggin' idiot, this effectively gave him immortality, and he dabbled into black magic and cast some curses on himself to halt the flesh-eating curse's effect, thus beginning a long chain of evil misdeeds that have caused so much suffering across the entire KI universe that listing them all would probably take longer to explain than this entire countdown. Long story short, Santa certainly isn't going to bring him any presents anytime soon. Many years later, he was captured and burned alive for posing as a messenger of the gods, and his ashes were sealed away inside of a chamber by the Night Guard. But logic doesn't exactly exist with these types of games, and thusly he came back from the dead and went on a quest to kick the crap out of everybody he ran into and collect their relics to power himself up. Oh, and he was also the one responsible for releasing Gargos from the astral plane. Gee, thanks for giving us an apocalypse, asshole. Khonra's playstyle is sort of an acquired taste, but he's still fun nonetheless. He has plenty of goodies going for him, such as being able to create sand clouds for positioning and some very tricky but oh so satisfying juggling, or sand spikes that can create portals for some annoying trapmaster abilities, and being able to summon a sand hand to launch you closer to your opponents. But if you thought Sadira was annoying to fight, then, well, you'd be right, but Khonra takes cheap to a whole new level. He has the qualities of a trapmaster, alongside being able to hit you almost anywhere on the stage. Yeah, as if maining this guy doesn't make you an absolute dick to fight against. Serious or not, maining Khonra is guaranteed to leave plenty of sand and salt up the ass cracks of your opponents. And I should probably leave before the out of context users find my video. Many people have often pointed out that Killer Instinct is sort of a parody to a lot of other fighting games. And yes, that's true, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. In fact, I'd call this game a parody of Street Fighter, but with a lot more simplicity, faster paced combat, and way more variety. But of course, we also have Ryu to Street Fighter as Jago is to this game. And not just by typical playstyle similarities, his thrust kick, his uppercut, his Endokan. No, I said Endokan. Are you even listening to me right now, Jago? Guys, better give him some cookies. I don't think he's messing around here. Yeah, you get the point. And even his story is similar. Both warriors wish to journey to test and purify themselves of the evil that once corrupted them. The only difference is Jago's sword and tiger paint. Playstyle-wise, I feel that Jago is the best character in the game for a player's first outing. The best way to describe him is balanced. He has a great range of fast and in-your-face attacks, and range with... No, we're not doing that. His instinct is also really good. Jago can fire two...
and with each Hadouken, he regains a little bit of health for each successful hit. Jago also gets bonus points for having one of the best songs in the entire game. So, why is he so low? Well, let me clarify. It's probably just a me thing, but I've never found myself maining the poster character of any fighting game. Now I know that Sub-Zero was in my top 3 in my Mortal Kombat X video, but he's not exactly the poster character. I mean, if I ever invest enough time into a fighting game, I'm usually gonna go with somebody else. But it might just be a dumb quirk of mine that may or may not be stupid. And before you say anything, they didn't even have full gore in the game until 3 months after the game's launch. So yes, I say that Jago is the main character. So if you want to get into this game, then this is the guy you turn to first. Just bring a batch of cookies with you before you do. Truth be told, I actually started writing the script for this countdown before the final character of Season 3 ever came out. But even with the update, my ordering for this list hasn't really changed in the slightest. But it was a little difficult to order the final character's place on the list. Season 3 had given us 3 guest characters, 1 newcomer, and 3 other veterans from games past. And since there was only 1 character missing from previous games, guessing who the last character to get in the game was pretty obvious. Idol. Ugh, man, is this thing ugly. He looks dead. Well, truth be told, he kinda is dead. Now, I wasn't really that interested when he was first announced, but after doing some more research the very next day, my hype levels went through the roof. Most old school KI fans might remember that Idol was originally the main antagonist and final boss of the original Killer Instinct on the SNES. In the reboot, Idol was locked in battle with Gargos in the Astral Plane, but Idol lost and had his head split in half. Ouch. And it said that Idol was so powerful that he was the only being alive to ever give Gargos any real trouble. Wow. If he could give Gargos a hard time, who might I add is quite possibly the strongest character in the KI universe canonically, then how much of a chance does the rest of the cast have against this monster? Knowing this, the Sorcerer Khan-Ra found his corpse and brought him back to life so that he can use Idol against Gargos in the upcoming Battle of Armageddon. Well, Idol don't play by daddy's rules, and he left on his own. But not before beating Khan-Ra's sandy butt into the next decade. Because if Idol was gonna get his revenge, then he was gonna do it his own way. Now, this is where things really get interesting. First impressions will tell you that, yes, Idol is a berserker, and you'd be right, but what makes him so special is his two heads, the warrior head and the mage head. You start off playing as one of the two forms depending on the opening interactions. The red head goes in clubs a blazing, but the mage head is used for zoning and field control. So yes, you pretty much get two characters in one, and you'll have to adapt to getting used to switching back and forth between both heads throughout the match. Trust me, it's not nearly as annoying as you might think. And after certain combos or shadow moves, you'll be thrust into using one head while the other head falls asleep. Lazy bastard. I guess it's because since his head is now split in two, he doesn't have nearly as much control over his powers as before. But his instinct really lets him bring out his full potential. Once activated, there is no hope for your opponent. All of his attacks get an insane boost in range and power, and he gets the benefit of both forms. So in the end, Idol went from the cheapest boss fight ever at the time, with questionable parental issues, to this thing. The moment you select that 26 icon, you become everyone's worst nightmare. There are many games out there that I was very excited for in 2016. Some games were one-hit wonders for me, while one or two games were just downright disappointments. Killer Instinct Season 3 on Windows 10 was one of those one-hit wonders. After hearing about Maximilian Dude and watching his videos, I was pretty excited to play the game for myself. It took me until June 2016 to finally get my own copy, but hey, better late than never. But while I was waiting for the game to come out, I had analyzed each character and singled out the characters I wanted to main the most. But here's the thing, you never know who you'll main until you play the game for yourself. And that's where Maya comes into play. Truth be told, Maya was not a character I wanted to main when I first played the game, but when I picked her up, I ended up having way more fun playing as her than I initially thought I would. I mean, granted, she's not in my top 10, but my point still stands. Maya was one of the best warriors in the group called the Night Guard, and if you recall from earlier, so was Mira. But after Ultra Tech had completely effed things up for the world, every monster and madman had escaped, but not before killing every one of Maya's friends in the process. The bad thing? Conra was one of the escapees. Now Maya is on a mission with Conra's daggers, Temperance and Vengeance, to find the sorcerer and destroy him once and for all. There's not much different about Maya's playstyle that I can say that I haven't already said before, but her unique style gives her points for creativity. Outside of her cheerleader flips and her spiral jump kick, she can toss her daggers at her opponents for range. There's more to this than meets the eye, however, seeing as you'll lose a dagger if you miss or your opponent blocks. To make things worse, you'll have to go pick it up or activate your instinct in order to get it back. And it's not like she's hopeless without them. She can still wreck shop, and using your flips or dodges constantly means an easy grab without stopping. Plain and simple, she's basically Vega, but with boobs and ranged attacks. Did I seriously just say that out loud? But one of her best traits is her instinct. Instead of having to constantly pick her daggers up, her daggers will come back to her after she throws them, thus giving her much better versatility. And if your opponent makes a sensible decision to block your dagger throws, your daggers will get added bonuses the more they're blocked. So you get benefits either way you go. Hey, Screw Attack, how about we get a death battle between Maya and Vega? Make it happen! There are tons of characters in Killer Instinct with varying playstyles and personalities, but I don't think anybody fits the nature of KI better than Saberwolf. At least as far as the gameplay goes. Saberwolf is the latest descendant of a rich family known as, well, the Von Saberwolf clan. Back in his human years, he went under the name of Baron Conrad Von Saberwolf, and was a snarky rich kid who loved to party and drink his life away. But after discovering an alchemic lab in a castle that he inherited from his dead parents, he ended up cutting his arm on a claw from a werewolf's severed limb, and he turned into a werewolf himself. Huh, is that how that works? But after getting into some funny business with Ultratech, he escaped and eventually developed an addiction to potions and black magic, desperately trying to find a cure for his condition, fearing that he may lose himself to his blind wolf-like rage. And befitting of his nature as a werewolf, his playstyle is just the same. Quick and brutal. He's quick to attack with his claws, leap attacks, and he can somehow dash past his opponents. Like a certain sexy cowgirl that can shoot a person on the other side of the planet, I shall never understand video game logic. Granted, it's pretty risky business to have to go up close and in your opponent's face, but Saberwolf is very good at covering all areas of the opponent's defenses. Now, while I do find some enjoyment in playing as him, that doesn't exactly mean that I like everything about him. I'm not exactly the biggest fan of characters that have massive amounts of "fuck you, I'm a werewolf" and nothing else. He also has one of the weakest instincts in the game. The only thing that this does is cause more chip damage, even if the opponent is guarding. And frankly, it's not that useful or fun to use. Luckily, he does get points for his ultra combo and for having one of my personal favorite stages. And clearly a lot of people seem to like Saberwolf, considering that he's one of Maximilian Dude's mains, and he's also my good friend Budger Ray's best character. So, why isn't he one of mine? I mean, is it because I'm not freak enough? Ah, c'est la vie.